transfer mechanism to deal with the arbitrary number of data items without having to write the separate name for each one of these data items in the program code. Now, the nature of the Prolog language, where the expressions, so all data is immutable. Immutability has a lot of advantages, as we know, even in the imperative programming world, but it has one unfortunate downside. So if you have some kind of a large object and you want to make a slight modification of it, like an array, that in Prolog, this would necessitate create a new copy of that entire array and then one item different. So Prolog is not dealing with the really arrays at all. Now there is some extensions that give arrays and the dictionaries and such seemingly mutable data structures, and then we can access them through the Prolog interface, but the Prolog logical purity is not, of course, maintained with these extensions. But a far better structure, so because Prolog expressions are arbitrary terms, that they're just nodes and pointers in memory, so they can be arbitrary large. So remember, there's no strings in there except in the source code. Also, so because Prolog programming doesn't deal with arrays, so then it very much doesn't deal with strings either. So if strings are treated as a character arrays, one instruction I read in some material said that in Prolog program you should never be dealing with strings except when you read them in, then parse them into Prolog structures, and then do your logic on the structure, Prolog structure, instead of a string. So then you can write the results out as a human readable text after the actual computation has taken place at the level of a Prolog expression trees. Now, Prolog expression trees, so they can encode basically anything, but this common idea of a list and the Prolog lists are gonna be a bit of an opposite to Python lists. Python lists are arrays with the slack space in the end. So Python list, it's efficient to append to the end and pop from the end. So that one is a constant time amortized. But in Prolog, the lists are manipulated from the front. So adding and removing from the front, that's the efficient operation, because every Prolog list is actually a pair, the first element followed by the rest. And the actual syntax for lists so horrendous that nobody would ever write the code with the actual list expressions. But just like we have a syntactic sugar of the infix arithmetic and comparisons for human readability, so we also have a syntactic sugar of a list notation. And lists, so let's do the system predicate length, and so that we get to demonstrate the Prolog lists in action. So list, same as in Python, so expressions written between between square brackets, and let's make a list with the elements 42, Bob divided by Joe plus 7, and the string hello, and let's put a list that contains 4, 5, 6, and so here we have a list. And then, so let's ask, so length, the predicate, given a list, then unify the result with the length of the list. So this list has a length of 4. So the list notation, so a whole bunch of things written between square brackets. So each element can be an arbitrary Prolog expression, and lists are Prolog expressions, so we can use lists. Lists are just a special case of this Prolog term, so we can encode arbitrary complicated structures there. Now the list predicates that we're gonna be looking at, so they are there in the standard library, but now just to demonstrate in the program that we see in the left, that we will soon look at, that we could easily, using this unification and the backtracking execution, so those are already Turing complete, so we could use them to write all these predicates ourselves in Prolog. So So we couldn't really do that in Python. So how much Python do you need to know to write the working Python? So the Prolog is a very, very homo-iconic and a very tight language. So at this length predicate, now let's for the purposes of the reversibility, so length, so again, so two parameters. So notice that both, so the list and the length, so which here is int. So Prolog doesn't have types, but we can say int to say that something's gonna be an integer. That both can be unbound. So this works both ways. So let's see the length of the list, 1, 2, 3. So we already saw length, sorry. But we can also ask, what kind of a list has 4 elements? A list that in its most general form, so consists of 4 unbound variables that looks like this were allocated from top of the stack. So now this have suddenly become, with the stride of 6 earlier video, these numbers used to grow by 4. So, and we can ask, what kind of a list has what kind of a length? So this one has an infinite number of solutions. So sometimes a predicate can legitimately have an infinite number of solutions and that they're all produced. So this would never stop, but this can now produce the solutions one at a time. We have to force stop it ourselves. So this kind of a nice linear sequential infinity of solutions, and then a well-behaved predicate then can produce these solutions one at a time. So of course never produces all of them, but provided that you wait long enough, so this will always get to any particular solution. So this is the ideal that we're trying to reach in writing, so that all of these arguments, they can be unbound. So the between, so we remember that the first two arguments had to be bound. So in some situations, the infinity of solutions is so nasty branching that we don't expect the predicate to do it. Now the length predicate, so now to demonstrate the power of the recursive rules and then the pattern matching, the realization that, so let's see how the unification works with the list. So every list in reality is consists of the first element, the head, and then the rest of the elements, the tail. And like for the unification, so we can use, so we can separate the head and the tail in the syntactic sugar with the vertical bar. So here, this unification works. With the head is always the first element, like if the first element is integer, so then the head is an integer. If the first element was, let's say, a list, so now we see that the first element, so it's a list, so then the head is a list. So head is whatever the first element expression is, so it can be whatever. But notice, so the tail is always a list, no matter what. Like for example, well here it has to be because the tail contains 2 elements. But even if a tail contains just 1 element, so notice it is then a 1 element list. So if the tail is always a list, so there's no exception to the rule. So what is the head and the tail of a... So the first element is 1 and then it's followed by nothing. So empty list, bit of a bad font choice, so that's an open square and closing square with no space in between. So looks like this Unicode, the unknown character mark. So hey, the list has a tail, but then, so if this is an empty list. So now this is very important for these recursive predicates. When we're writing the rules, when we're implementing the length predicate next, that so... An empty list does not unify with the non-empty list. So the non-empty, this one says there's got to be a head. So there's got to be the first element. The list cannot be empty. The tail can be empty. But now asking, so suppose I wanna unify with at least must have at least 2 elements. So this syntax extends. So you can say, so the there has to be at least two elements. So when we write the recursive rule to process a list to do something, that the rule is in effect only if there is at least two elements. So this is how we would do it. So we say, match the first element with this and the second element with that, and then whatever follows could be empty, non-empty, match with that. So we can write this matching rules for a list of arbitrary structures. And now let's look at the my length here as an example. So I follow the convention that making my own version of a system predicate. So then give it the my so that there's no confusion. So the my length, let's ask. So my length, the list that has three elements. But this first rule, the base case of the recursion in line one, says that so this is not going to be very common, the base cases for the recursive rules of the list predicates, that if the list is empty, then the length is zero. So this will correctly answer that L is zero. Now, even though we have two different rules for my length, we've written these rules carefully now that there is no choice, there is no non-determinism, because there is no possible expression that can simultaneously match the empty list. An unbound variable would be matching both, but there is no list that is simultaneously empty and then has at least one element. So these two rules in that situation are exclusive. So only one of them gets executed. And if we do the trace here, let's see how this goes. So make this call 1, 2, 3 and the L, a new variable from the stack. So it didn't match the rule in the line 1, but matched the rule at line 3, and now we have a recursive. So the tail, the T has been matched with the tail. So now my length 2, 3, calculate that one, and calculate the length of 3, length of the empty list. So then that matches the fact, and doesn't match the rule, so every recursion must have a base case. And at the previous level, so now binding L, so L2 has now been bound to 0, so it's possible to execute L is L2 plus 1, binding L to 1, and then we find out that the length of the list 3 is 1, and the length is built up on the way back. Now, the inefficiency of recursion, so this is now, I put it this way, because it's the simplest way to explain. But this my length, so this rule, notice the recursive call here is not a tail recursive call. So then it would be better if this call was after, it was the last thing in the body. We'll spend future videos taking a look at the mechanistic transformations of how to always do this, but we do have the downside of a recursion here, so that if we try to calculate the length of a list, we would get some kind of a list with a million elements, we get a stack overflow. But the reversibility of the predicates, so we can make a list that has a length of 10,000. I'm not gonna echo it there, so I'm used to underscore, and I can ask, so what is the length of that list now? So it's 10,000. So let's see how many I can do before I my length, of course, so length doesn't, but if you use my length, notice it was massively slower because we didn't use a tail recursion, so every call generates new things to the stack. So how many am I gonna? Now I now notice I run out of the stack limit, so in the my length. Whereas, now this list itself became so huge that I ran out of memory. Now another quite handy. Let's see if let's before that see if my length is generative, so they cannot give me a three element list. Yes, it can. But then it got stuck in an infinite loop. So it is because I don't use tail recursion and I don't use cut. So we can later do this much better. And can we? Well, then of course we cannot. We can. So this one actually worked out. So if both were unbound, behaving the same as length. Very nice. Okay, now there's another one. This one is looks like it's not as powerful as it is, but append. So if I append 1, 2, 3, and 4, 5, 6, what do I get? So I get this one. But this one has surprising powers because it's fully general and fully reversible. So append is going to take place of a whole bunch of for loops that if we were solving problems in a Python or similar language, that we would be writing a for loop. But append, because it can do things like, so it can notice that this could be unbound, but then even better, so what if these are both unbound? Looping through all possible ways to split a list into two pieces, so all the possible ways to split in half. Now this also produced, as you can see, so either one could be empty, but we could of course say that because unification can deal with arbitrary expressions both ways. It's perfectly symmetric. So eliminates the thinking that we have in imperative languages that the function arguments are somehow different thing than a function result. But so in a relation, so a well-designed relation works both ways. Head one. So now I got all the possible ways to break this list into two non-empty pieces. Notice I said that both pieces must have at least one element. So this append, notice how prefix and suffix are also its trivial special cases. So L1 is a prefix of L2 if there exists something that you can append to L1 to make L2, and then the suffix the other way around. So L1 is a suffix of L2 if there exists something that when you append L1 to it, you get the all the possible suffixes. So append generates them its own solutions one by one, and then my suffix is gonna generate as many solutions as that one does. So this recursive rules, we're gonna go through a ton of examples in these videos, but they are that the base case is an empty list, or for some problems could be a singleton list also, and then the general case a rule that doesn't match the base case. So then these lists predicates deal with the list by going with the elements from beginning to end. But now, so it's better to use tail recursion, organize the logic in a way that the recursive call is at the end of the body, because that one is more merciful and more efficient in many ways.